sacrifices the look on the stage for the slides. Okay, I'll do that. So, the slides are a bit too bright, and if I like lower the brightness on the camera,
just keep it the way it is.
Okay.
This is going good. If it's working, don't worry about how it looks for now. This is good.
Okay.
Just keep the party done. That's just waiting for you.
Right. the colors. I love all the beautiful things that spring brings. So, how about those pictures I've given them? Anyway, yesterday we hosted our Wise Women of Faith for the Hospitality Workshop, and it was so awesome because we got to talk about all kinds of things. We've got some of them up there, some of the beautiful women helping out. And I just enjoyed, because one of the things we talked about and that we really focused on was friendships. And I thought, what kept me going as a disciple for 5 years? And we talked about biblical qualities of friends. And in the book of Proverbs, it talks about your presence, your words, your love, your humility, honesty, warnings, what to avoid, and that Jesus is my constant. And I thought, what? I just loved, I learned so much. I was so convicted during that study. Because I thought, my goodness, I have so much more to learn about friendship. Then I thought about how many years I was looking through, and I'm going to read some too, because I don't want to try to do it, this is so amazing. But how many of you in this church have friends, and I want you to stand in this church for 10 to 20 years. Stand up if you have friends in this church for even over 10 to 20 years. Look around, guys. That's totally lovely. That's lovely, because I go to a lot of different churches and people have friends in the church. Very rarely they have friends. In Proverbs 18:24, it says, one who has other reliable friends soon comes to ruin. But there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. And Monique and I were talking yesterday because we were looking over some books, and one of the books was A Woman After God's Own Heart. And in the book, she said, well, who gave that to you? Like, who's the person who gave that to you? So, this is from 2001, and I'm going to tell you the name. You guys want to know the name? Dearest Tara, God knew I needed you in my life. Not only as a partner, but a best friend. I'm really excited to see what God will do. We should just strive to imitate the heart of Jesus. Thanks for all your love and encouragement. 2001. This book has been a seed that I've given to a lot of women, but this is the thing that we're talking about.
It's
welcoming you here
better.
About
it's
not taking
definitely
relationships.
Better.
Yeah.
This sounds like it's coming from a tin can, you know, like that going through a gymnasium.
I am so
convicted.
I think it's still
so many times I've taken these
sound off the
camera.
And
I don't want to cry about
somehow.
It, but it's true. But, I love God. I just want to welcome you to an amazing family.
Right,
it's an amazing kingdom of God. And so, spring is an opportunity to recharge, rekindle the relationships, because I'm excited about what I learned about relationships and repent where I need to. But spring is renewal.
Yes.
It's the resurrection. It's all this great stuff. Isn't that awesome? And Julia, please, you can have it. Yay! And my beautiful daughter is going to shoot. I'm so proud of you. I see a lot of you on wearing green, so never leave you, bind them around your neck, write them on your top of the heart, then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and in Proverbs 3:3-4. One thing I loved about yesterday's Women's Hospitality Day was about the friendship. In order to like get the most out of it, you have to put in a lot of effort and be vulnerable in all your relationships. And here's a joke from Old Man Chair. It says, I want to be so full of Christ that if a mosquito bites me, it flies away singing, there is power in the blood. Have a great day.
Many of you here know, one of the projects that we have going on in our church is called 1,000 Tables. And that's where we are showing the hospitality of Jesus to our friends, our family, our neighbors, even strangers. And at the end, we're going to collect all these photos and build this huge collage of love. Well, in the same vein, in communion today, I'm going to talk about probably one of the most famous sessions that's ever happened, and that was when Jesus met with his disciples at the Lord's Supper, at the Last Supper. So open your Bibles to Matthew 26, verse 20. I'm actually going to read from the Message, because I like how it's a little bit different, but I like how it's written. It says, after sunset, could it be me? Jesus answered, the one who hands me over is the one I eat with daily, the one who passes food. Turns traitor to the Son of Man. Better never to have been born than this. Then Judas already turned to the traitor and said, it isn't me, is it, Rabbi? Jesus said, don't play games with me, Judas. During the meal, Jesus took and blessed the bread, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. Take, eat, this is my body. Taking the cup and thanking God, he gave it to them. Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, God's covenant, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I will not be drinking wine from this cup again until that day when I drink it with you in the kingdom of my Father. They sang a hymn and went directly to the Mount of Olives. When I was at San Diego State, I took an art. One of the persons that we focused on a lot was Leonardo da Vinci, okay? And his famous and largest painting that he had ever done is The Last Supper. So in art history class, you do an interpretation of that artist's drawing. Well, this morning, rather than Charlie Montecalvo telling you about the, and giving my perspective on the communion, I'm going to let Leonardo teach you, okay? So, this is Lord's Supper, and what I love about this, you're going to see as we go through this, I want you to note how calm Jesus is amongst all of this chaos. So, first thing, a little background behind this, this painting is in Milan, Italy, at a monastery, painted on a wall. It is huge. It's the biggest one that Leonardo ever did. It is 15 feet high. It's higher than the top of a basketball backboard, and 30 feet wide. A lot larger than the crushed velvet pictures that all my Filipino relatives had hanging in the dining room table. Or Da Vinci, who said, if you want to get in this group selfie, you need to get on this side of the table. Ooh. You know, one of those things, that was a joke, guys. But if you notice, they're all on the same side of the table. Nobody sits like that anymore. But seriously, so the thing I love about what this artist does is how he portrays how Jesus is amongst all of this chaos. So take a look. Over here to my right, we have Bartholomew, James son of Alphaeus, and we have Andrew. is down after the resurrection of Jesus. And then you have the protagonist of this whole story. You have John the Beloved fainting.
No audio now.
Who is James's brother. And then you have Peter leaning over. And look what he has in his hand. And then his elbow knocks over a shaker of salt, which is not in the Bible, but in those times when you knock over a shaker of salt, it's a sign that you're about to betray your master. So you have all of this going on, and the thing I want you to notice is you have all of this chaos that Jesus makes this announcement, and yet what does Da Vinci do with Jesus? His elbow knocks over a shaker of salt. Jesus is calm, focused, resolute, despite knowing that his disciples were about to desert him, disown him, and betray him, Jesus stayed calm, focused, and resolute. Knowing that outside, just outside, Jesus also on top of that, Jesus not only knew what was going to happen with his disciples, what was going outside, but for the next 16 hours, he's going to undergo probably the most excruciating, painful, and humiliating death anyone has ever gone through. And yet Jesus stayed focused, calm, and resolute. If I were Jesus, I'd be sweating, trembling, shaking. I'd ask to be excused several times to go outside and vomit, and I'd be so nervous. And when it came time to talk about the bread and the cup, I'd be crying like a little baby. This is my bread. I would be so nervous knowing that all of this was going to happen to me. And yet Jesus stayed focused, calm, and resolute. What I appreciate about this is knowing that when I go through tough times, when things are in chaos, whether it's in school, or whether it's our marriage, or whether it's our family, or whether it's bills, or whatever, Jesus is saying, stay calm. I am here with you. Take my yoke. My burden is easy. I'm gentle and kind.
I guess I'm learning these lines.
We're about to take communion. And what I love about this, at the very end, look what it says. This is my blood, the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now until that day when I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom. When they had summoned him, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Among all this chaos, Jesus goes, okay, guys, calm down. Let's at least sing a song. And then we'll go pray to get you guys calm. When he's the one who should be nervous. So different. We're going to go ahead and sing a couple songs, and I'll come up and then say a prayer. So we're going to sing songs like they did in the Mount of Olives. Amen. Let's all stand up. And as we sing these two songs before we take the bread and the juice, I just really want you guys to really just focus on the words and who we are singing to.
Here I am to worship.
God, we love you. And yet our love is nowhere close than the love you have for us. And we appreciate that because without you, we would not know the chance to go to heaven and be here together. As we think about communion, pray that you be with our hearts and help us be excited knowing that that meal that we talked about was the last you had until you return. We look forward to that. That's why we keep remembering this special day and time in your life. God, I pray that you bless us. Be with us as we think about how you broke your body for us and how you gave your blood so our sins can be forgiven. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Sounds great. All right, at this time, we're all going to stand up, so let's stand up. We're going to have about a five-minute fellowship break, 2-minute fellowship break. So meet somebody next to you that you have not seen before. Talk to them, say hi. We're going to come back in 2 minutes with a song.
start finding our seats. Let's wrap up the conversation and start finding our seats.
Church YouTube channel, and so we figured out, I want to give a little
little shout out. Kelvin Daniels and Jesus Magana in the back. They spent 6 hours in training yesterday. Volunteer training. So I'm taking them to lunch today to say thank you. But we got it figured out. We're online. So you can text your friends or family. Go on to SD.CHURCH, our YouTube channel. Our service is live. You can see everything there. On our YouTube channel. Good morning. Welcome to the San Diego Church. We are a church of imperfect people following a perfect Savior. Amen. So we're grateful that you're online visiting with us. I'm even more grateful that you're here physically with us. You know, I do want to say a special thanks to friends and family. You know, there's a friend here. I already said hi to him. I told him I'm gonna put him on blast only because out of respect. You know, man, I were young college interns in the central region, leading the mission sector. And Steve and Sue Shaw thought that, man, I could do ministry. They assigned us to the Bouquets and the Schmellings. Said, hey, take care of these young couple. They're trying to help us be in the ministry. We were leading, May and I were not even dating, leading a sector of 110 people in the Mission Center region. And I want to say a special note to a mentor, 52 Bible Talks for Fun and Profit. He's the author of it. He taught me how to do Bible Talks. He helped me, and he wasn't even there physically. But Dave and Sue Schmelling are visiting this morning. A shout out, Dave and Sue Schmelling. Welcome to our ministry. Much respect. Much love and appreciation. We were getting together for discipling times. We knew they were helping us. And we were talking about marriage. And Mary and I, Steve and Sue, don't talk about marriage or anything else. Just talk about Jesus. Amen. But they are faithful disciples of Jesus. And I'm so grateful that you're here visiting with us this morning. I do want to say a special note. This past week, a long-standing member here, even before I was the minister, had passed away this past week, Mike Chikaraki. So some of you know him. He passed away suddenly. He had some health complications. I do want to make sure we're saying a special prayer for the Chikaraki family. They're based in Connecticut. I do want to say a special prayer for the Shocks. Steve and Jennifer Shock have done so much to help Mike over the years, as well as so many of you. So thank you. Definitely keep him, his family, in our prayers as we continue to mourn the loss of Mike Chikaraki physically. You know, we do know that sad, but that's with family. You have all things. I want to remind us of our worship by the bay. That's Saturday. Write that down. April 13th. 6 to 9 p.m. is going to be our worship night by the bay. Last year we did it. I think it's going to be a tradition. It's going to be a great chance for us to go down to Humphreys by the bay. We're going to have a great... Parking is free. It's going to be a great concert. We're going to have concessions available. Last time we did, we'll have popcorn, nachos, chips, drinks, hot drinks. It's going to go from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. It's going to be amazing. Invite your friends and family. It's going to be fun. Feel free. I want to encourage you to go down early, like at 3 o'clock. Walk around Point Loma Park. Go have dinner and then join us. It's going to be an awesome time. And just so some of you know, I think someone's asking me, yes, church is still Sunday, April 14th. We'll be back here for church. Amen? I know Chuck was asking me that in his heart. Sometimes we've got to clarify, right? You know, we're so excited about 1,000 tables. We've talked about kicking that off. He talked about how Jesus welcomed the 5,000. He talked about how Jesus spoke and taught them. He talked about how Jesus healed them. And he was talking about how we're so glad that Jesus is the bread of life. And I really appreciate the things that he challenged us with. The thing I was challenged by, Kyle said, let's aim to practice Christian hospitality by serving the needs of strangers around us. I pray you've been serving the needs of strangers around you, practicing hospitality. Today, we're going to continue Meals with Jesus. I do want to, we're going to be talking about some great things. So why are we doing this? My wife always helps me. So honey, why are we doing this? We're doing 1,000 tables because we want to connect with people, share life with friends and family, and meet people at the dinner table just like Jesus. We want to connect with them. We want to love them like Jesus. So one thing we want to encourage you to do, and I'm laughing a little bit, because May and I had an amazing dinner Friday with our friends Brian and Antoinette, and I'm going to confess this publicly because we didn't do it, but it's going to be open. So we had a great dinner at our house. We hosted Ryan and Antoinette for dinner. It was awesome. They cooked this amazing meal. And so one thing we're doing is we're having dinner and we're taking pictures. And then we're posting these pictures at that phone number there. so that we can post those pictures. Well, we had an amazing dinner with Ryan and Antoinette. And then we had an amazing conversation. And then we started talking about the Bible. We pulled the Bible out and we talked about the Bible. Those were stuck and the older people at the table. And then we started to share, and then as they're about to leave the table, we go, we didn't take a picture of our table. So I'm going to encourage you, ask first. We didn't even take a picture. So we said this Thursday, we'll make it up to you. But just remember, we're doing this to be like Jesus and love people at the dinner table. Again, the goal, we're going to take pictures. We're going to post these pictures. The number, if you can't read it, 619-679-9445. Take a picture, send it there. We have a lot of pictures. It's really great. We had a great time. We can't wait to have dinner Thursday at our house, and we'll take a picture this time. So this morning, meals with Jesus. Verses 38 to 42, and we're talking about a meal at Mary and Martha's this morning. A meal at Mary and Martha's. Let me ask you a question. How would you feel if Jesus was at church? He's not, I'm just saying. If Jesus was at church today and he saw you, he said, hey, good morning, good to see you. Hey, I'd like to come to your house for lunch. How would you feel? Hey, so cool you drove all the way here to be with us, but hey, I want to come to your house and we're going to go to lunch. How would you feel if you knew that you're going to sit through service knowing you're going to have the Lord at your house for lunch? Now, I don't know about you. I feel a little bit anxious. I asked my wife, honey, did we clean the house before you came? Because I'm here first, she comes later. But I wonder, maybe there's a little sense of panic. Maybe there's a sense of wonder. Maybe there's a sense of, I know for me and I, what we would do, the first thing May would say is, stall, I'm going to drive home real quick after church. Stall him. Make sure he fellowships with everybody. Make sure he says hi. I'm going to go home. I'll get the house clean. Me and Jackson will get it clean. And Noah, we'll clean it up. We'll get ready. We'll light a candle. We'll make sure the bathroom's clean. Take the trash out of the kitchen. Take the trash out of the bathroom. And just, honey, stall him. That's what we would do. But what would you do if you knew Jesus was coming to your house for lunch? I think there would be some anxiety. I think there'd be some trepidation, and today we're just going to unpack a meal with Mary and Martha at their house, and what Jesus had done with them. Let's pray before we open the scriptures. Let's pray. God, what a blessing that Jesus is to all of us. I love that Jesus meets us at the table. I love that Jesus, you take us where we're at. I love you, Father, that you sent Jesus so that we can have a relationship. And I pray this morning, as we unpack the scriptures, I pray that each of us would be able to let the scriptures speak to us. Help us read this like it's the first time. That we learn, that we listen, open our ears, open our hearts and our minds, as we hear the scripture like we're hearing it for the first time. Or we're reading it for the first time. God, thank you for your spirit you've given us as a deposit in our lives as faithful disciples of yours. Please be with those in the Chickalacky family. Strengthen them. Strengthen the Shock's family. And so many others who are mourning the loss of Mike Chickalacky. Be with so many others who are going through health challenges. Be with Laura Fouts and her sister who needs a liver transplant. She's going to prayerfully go see her. And I pray for her health that God, you would comfort her. Be with my mother-in-law, Yvonne Lindo, who's in the hospital, who needs to see the cardiologist, who needs a procedure. God, give us next steps for May's mom's health and her well-being. And strengthen the Lindo family. You know, it's an emotional time. Give us wisdom. Give us insight. Let the scripture speak to us. We thank you for Jesus. We pray in his name, and the church says. Luke 10, 38. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me. Martha, Martha,
Lord answered, "You're worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." One practice I do when I read the Bible is I read it and I sit still. Sit still, and what does the scripture speak to you? Maybe you can circle something. What stands out to you in this passage? What resonates? What grabs your attention? What stands out to you? What provokes your heart? Maybe what challenges you? What stands out to you? Think about that for a second. I believe it's so important that we don't fill silence with fill space with silence, but with noise, but with silence. And that we're allowing, what does the passage say to me? Do we take the time to be still enough to listen or wait for the sermon and the person to share the example and illustration? You know, for me, when I think about this story, Martha opens her home to Jesus. Jesus comes over, and Martha is practicing hospitality. Mary, Martha's younger sister, is having the time of her life, sitting at Jesus' feet and listening, learning, and taking things in. And then Martha, on the other hand, she is so busy with preparations and getting things done, she goes over to Jesus and tells him to tell Mary, "Hey, tell her to help me." And Jesus basically says, "Well, Mary doesn't need to be like you, Martha. You need to be more like Mary." And wait a minute, isn't Martha? She's the one who was showing hospitality by having Jesus into her house. See, you got to remember, though, it's the attitude of hospitality that's important as well. What attitude do we give when they're in our house? And Martha had a different little bit of attitude. Not being hurried. We got to be mindful of not being worried or frenzied or stressed. Sometimes we forget about just being hospitable to the people in front of us. And we're worried about so many other things. You ever been around someone peaceful and been irritated by them because they're so peaceful? You're like, "Dude, hey Jesus, can you tell my little sister, get her act together and help me?" And Jesus is like, "Martha, Martha, you're worried about many things. But Mary has displayed what's most important." Again, if Jesus came to your home for lunch today, would you be more like Martha or would you be more like Mary? I don't think Jesus cares what he put your sermon. Was it steak? Was it prime rib? Was it the best? He wouldn't care what you're serving because Jesus is there to love people and serve them. So this morning, I took away three things from this passage as I read this passage all week, the last 3 weeks. Okay, what do I want to preach about? What's the Spirit telling me? When I look at this time, these are three things that resonate for me. I want to focus on three things. Number one, priorities. Number two, distractions. And number three, choices. Now, if we get to the last two, that'll be great. There's no guarantees. But when I think of the important, when I look at this passage, look at Jesus exemplifying and asking us, what are your priorities? Verse 41 through 42, "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you're worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed, or indeed, only one." I really believe when you repeat someone's name, they're trying to make a point. There's an emphasis. So did Martha get it? Martha, Martha. Jesus is teaching and showing, you're worried and upset about many things. Aren't you at peace when people are in the house? Maybe you're not. That's an opportunity for you to grow. Amen. But the important thing is displaying hospitality. Jesus is teaching, are you having the right priorities? Are you worried about the meal? Are you worried about if it's cold or not? Or are you taking your eyes off of the person that's sitting time to go, don't forget the right priorities. The consequences of distractions can cause us to worry. We can get upset. So what are you worried about and upset today? Jesus is coming to lunch. What are you going to be worried about and upset with today? What will be permeating out of you? It can be many things, and there's been a lot going on in our lives. But verse 39, it says, She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet, her priority. Mary sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he said. So I really believe this morning, what's your priority? What's your priority in life? What's your priority at work? What's your priority in marriage? What's your priority in your community? This morning, Mary's priority was sitting at the feet and listening to Jesus. Mary was displaying, prioritizing the right things in her life. Amazing things that Jesus provides. You know, being in the Philippines, a third world country, there's a lot of things in the third world country you can begin to complain about, but they're not a third world issue, it's a first world problem. Let me give you an example. You know, we were in the Philippines for almost 3 weeks. And every morning, but not every morning, because I went to a resort the last 4 days to have a warm shower. But normally in the third world country, we stay in this nice little apartment, we're getting ready for midweek, and I turned the shower on, and of the 35 spigots, only two worked. And the water was just ice cold. So I began to grumble. Where am I? I got a healthy dose of humility. That's right, I'm in a third world country. I'm having a first world problem. I'm having a first world issue. This is a first world problem. This is not something for me to worry about. This is an opportunity for me to be grateful that at least I have two spigots of the 35 working. Now the shower took longer than normal. And it was chillier than I've normally been used to. But I want to help you understand, sometimes we can worry about certain things that aren't really things for us to worry about. And I think this displays for us, worrying distracts us from worshiping Jesus. Worrying distracts us from worshiping God. Martha's worry kept her from truly honoring Jesus. Looking at others distracts us from looking at Christ. Poor Martha's resentment for her sister kept her from enjoying Jesus is in her own house. Just be grateful that he's there. Give him the attention. But again, this is in the Bible so that us collectively can learn from Mary and we can learn from Martha about the importance of our own priorities. How are your priorities? You know, it's interesting. Few things are needed, indeed only one, which is basically the main thing is to keep the main priority the main thing. Jesus should be our main priority as Christians. Can I get an amen, church? Jesus Christ should be the main priority for who we are in Christ. And he should be the most important thing we're spending time with than anything else peripheral. Are we having the right priorities? I think it's so essential to our whole being that we prioritize our time with being in the presence of Christ. Amen. Mary was in the presence of Christ. This past week, how is your presence with Christ? Did you sit still enough to be with him? Or was there a frenzied hurry of to-do lists? Now don't get me wrong, anyone in this room busy, everyone should raise their hand. Now, maybe the not young ones, they don't have any kids or big jobs yet, so they shouldn't be that busy. But a lot of times, we're all busy in perspective. But I want to remind us, it's so important for us to understand, May needs me to have the right priorities. Jesus is first, and my wife is second. Amen. I don't apologize. My wife has Jesus first, and I am second. It's important that she sits at the feet of Jesus before she comes and has to tolerate me. Because he needs prayer. And she's a patient woman. But I want to ask us this morning, Jackson and Jared, my kids, need me to make sure Jesus is a priority in my life. Yes. My nephew Noah needs me to make sure I'm displaying for him that Jesus is a priority in my life. What's taking up your priorities? What's taking up your time? I think practically, when I think about these things, practically priorities. You got to make it a priority in your schedule every week, every day. Spend time with Jesus. We need time with Jesus. Another thing, Matthew 6:33 says, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. It's important. Are we seeking first his kingdom or my kingdom? Are we seeking his kingdom? Making that a priority. You know, we as a church have four goals as a San Diego church. What's our first and major goal we have? Rhetorical question, don't everyone answer. But you should know what our goals are. We've talked about it consistently, regularly. Our number one goal is to deepen our walk with God. The most important relationship you have visiting with us this morning, we want to display and show you our priority is God and Jesus first. More important than any other relationship that we have. I think of the passage in Matthew chapter 7, 24 to 27. You want to be a wise builder? You want to be a foolish builder? I spent 24 years building foolishly. And the Bible simply says, those who hear my words and do what I say will be wise. Those who hear my words and don't do what I say will be foolish. Wherever it sits you and fits you, you have to understand, Jesus wants you to be a wise builder. And being a wise builder is not about you. It's about, is Jesus a priority in your life? Can I get an amen? It must be a priority in our life. When I think of all the people who were in the presence of Jesus and how impacted they were, you can't help but think of the litmus list of people. Mary Magdalene, she was grateful to be in the presence of Jesus. Nicodemus, forever changed. Zacchaeus, Matthew the tax collector, he's forever changed by being in the presence of Jesus. The woman at the well, the adulterous woman, Legion, the man who was compelled and controlled by thousands of different evil spirits, the paralyzed man on the mat, just by being in the presence of Jesus, he got the healing that he needed. Paul, Pontius Pilate, the thief on the cross. I can't help but think of Steve Schaff and Sue Schaff in our lives. How grateful. I was a college senior, just became a Christian. I was taking 20 units my last semester. And the first thing that Steve and I met together every week for our discipling time, guess what Steve talked about? Douglas, talk about your priorities. Your priorities are God first. Number two, your priorities are your family. And number three, you better do well in school for those 20 units. So let's go back to your priorities. If I'm not doing well in school, the question is, how's your relationship with God? It needs to be a priority in your schedule. If it's not in your schedule, it ain't in your schedule. It must be. And Steve ingrained to me as a man of God today, as a husband, as a father, as being a church builder, as leading the church, guess what I think about when man and I talk about all the time, every week? Let's talk about our priorities. We need to make sure the most important priority is our relationship with God. Amen? Second thing, distractions. Mary and Martha are sisters. Martha is the one who invites Jesus over. And yet she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet, her priorities, listening to what he said, but Martha was distracted by all the preparations. And I love Martha. Just spare me. I'm not an actor, but I'm just going to go there. Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work all by myself? Tell her to help me. I don't know if Martha did that, but I think she would show you she was just distracted by the wrong things. And the important thing this morning is what's distracting us. Don't you care? I mean, are you kidding, Martha? You're asking the Lord Jesus if he cares? She's trying to manipulate Jesus to feel something, and Jesus is like, Martha, Martha. I don't think he's minimizing her. I don't think he's dismissing her. I think Jesus is going, Martha, Martha. You're worried about a lot of things. And yet, indeed, the most important thing your sister was chosen to do. I think Jesus was teaching her a lesson of perspective. Understanding, we can be worried and distracted by many things. Think about the word distract. It's used only in the New Testament. It means to turn aside, to stir up, and confuse. A distraction is a thing that prevents someone from giving full attention to something else. Distracted driving kills an average of 9 people and injures over 1,000 every day in America. Cell phone use while driving increases risk of accidents by 400%. Companies lose an average of 720 hours annually to distractions per employees. And we're all tempted with distractions, and those distractions may vary for each of us. What is distracting you? Well, I'm glad you asked me. Thank you so much. Appreciate you asking. You know, we had a family time. May and I and Jackson and Noah, and we said, let's have a conversation about what's distracting us lately. Let's all pull our iPhones out. So do me a favor, if you have an iPhone, if you don't, we love you as well. But if you have an iPhone, pull your iPhone out. Pull your iPhone out and select settings. Yes, I'm doing this. Pull your iPhone out. I'm asking all of you, if you got an iPhone, pull your iPhones out. If you got an Android, we just pray for you. Or you're praying for me. Amen, I'll tell you. But pull your iPhone out, select settings, scroll down and select screen time. Oh, mercy, you're going to see some numbers. Select screen time. And when you pull screen time up, it tells you, on average, how much screen time you have in a day. Now, I'm still waiting for my nephew's number. I'm going to work through that with Noah. He didn't share his number with me, but we'll get there, Noah. But we shared our numbers. And the number one thing that took most of my time was the ESPN app. Now, I'm sharing just personally. You don't have to do this. But during the NFL playoffs, I was in my room mourning. There was a loss going on. Halftime, I went upstairs. All the people in my house were rooting for the other team. I had to go work it out with Jesus. My wife found me upstairs on the bed, listening to spiritual music, making sure I could be with Jesus. Because my team wasn't and my heart wasn't. But what I looked and understood as we talked at the family time, sometimes your screen time is a distraction. How much time are you devoting on your screens? So I deleted the ESPN app. I haven't seen it. I gotta type on my phone, ESPN.com, to look on my phone because I don't have the app. But you know, since I've deleted the ESPN app, I'm not as worried and anxious as I used to be about sports scores and who cares. Carolina lost last night. It was great. Wolfpack beat them. They deserved to win. It was awesome. But I'm going to encourage you. What are you dealing with your distractions? Have a conversation with your kids. How much screen time do you have? What are you working through? What takes the most of your screen time? What are you looking at? And have a conversation, because I really believe this morning we need to have a Jesus talk about what's distracting you. And maybe it's not your phone. Maybe it's your computer. And the second thing, the third thing, and the last thing we'll share about, I said we are going to get to it. You can select the next slide back there on streaming. That'd be great. Clicker's not working. But the last thing is choices. And we'll land the plane here. If you think about your choices, verse 42, Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. Mary makes the choice to be a student and learner at the feet of Jesus. It's so important for us as followers of Christ that we continue to remain students of Jesus. A student is not above his teacher. And I'd like to encourage us. I would like to think about this. Last week, me and I got together for a discipling circle, a group of couples to talk about life and talk about how we're doing to sharpen one another, to check in. We talked about kind of making sure, are we eagerly examining every day to see if what Paul says is true? Are we being great learners? And one thing I do during lessons is I take a lot of copious notes. I don't take the notes for you. I don't take the notes for the person next to you. I take the notes for me, because it helps me remain a great student of the Word, no matter who's talking or sharing. And the one thing I want to encourage, I have a concern. I feel like a lot of us are not being great students of Jesus. And as long as you've been a disciple, and some of you have been longer than I have, my question is, you never stop becoming a student. And I would like to get you to lean into, are you being a great student of Jesus? Let's be great students of Jesus, sitting in His presence, appreciating what Jesus is going to teach us. I'd like to call us today to look at our choices. I want to call us, get rid of the distractions. Amen. Number two, prioritize your spiritual life. And number three, choose daily to be like Mary and listen to Jesus. 2024 has already been a busy year. It's already been crazy. And there's so much to do. But I want to encourage you to learn from Mary and Martha this morning. And this week, spend some time going, hey, what did I learn about my priorities? Where am I doing? And how am I doing my own spiritual well-being? And how am I doing in really understanding the importance of my own choices? I love following Jesus, and I love this church because God gives you choice. You can show up or not. You can choose to follow or not. But the important thing is disciples. I'm looking at a room full of men and women who have chosen to make Jesus Lord. And I want to remind you and thank you. Thanks for your faith, Lord. Just for your many years of faith. Just standing together. Brian Fenniger, he's always ready. Thanks for being faithful. Thanks for choosing the right priorities. Thanks for leaving your family. Yo, Gabe, I appreciate having a tough time with your MCL.
Just in case.
Last night. But I appreciate your faith over the years as a young man. Your faithfulness to Jesus. Thanks for making the choice to be here. Matthew, he's a new disciple. Thanks so much for just your eagerness to change your mindset and follow Jesus. Artie got baptized yesterday. Artie. There's a picture yesterday. We found out there's two Carlsbad Tower, Lifeguard Tower 32. Amen. 300 yards south, but we found it. But Artie, I'm so proud of your faith. You've chosen to make Jesus Lord. He sacrificed the last 2 or 3 months. He came to church. He was transformed by the Bible. And you making the decision to become a disciple. Thanks so much for choosing Jesus. Many of you, I didn't say my name. Thanks for your faith. Thanks for showing up. Thanks for choosing Jesus. Thanks for obeying the scriptures. Thanks for making that call you had to make this past week. Thanks for making the decision. And for those that are visiting this morning, you're our friends, our neighbors, our family, we want you to help understand the right priorities in your own spiritual walk. And this morning, we don't have it all figured out as a church. We're not perfect. I want to remind us, a call to action. What resonates with you today? What resonates for you today? I urge those visiting, study the Bible. It will change your life. And this Thursday, we'll take a picture. That's why I need you to come in. And lastly, remember, being great students, not doing. Can I get an amen? There's a difference. Being a great student, sitting at the feet of Jesus, letting the scriptures hit your heart. I love you guys. Thanks so much for listening. Let's have a great week. the ICOC Laguna. Jim, I can only imagine you and the singers are working on some of those dance moves. You know, Jesse and Mildred, who lead the church in Laguna, are true tent makers after Paul's fashion, following Christ. They run a full-time business in addition to the church. I'd like to share a little bit now about our plans this year for the special contribution. With gratitude for your continued sacrifice to support the church, churches globally. Our special missions this year will be in some ways similar to previous years and in some ways a little bit different. The appeal will be the same as in the last 5 years, so 8 times your weekly contribution. The difference is that instead of one offering, which serves both foreign missions and local missions, this year it will be split into two separate offerings, one for foreign missions and one for local missions. The foreign missions appeal is for 5 times your weekly giving, and the local missions will be for 3 times. So 5 plus 3, you know, that is that 8 times our weekly giving. The foreign missions offering will be in May, and the local missions offering will be in September. The May 19th is the target date for the foreign missions contribution, and it will all go towards the 5 mission centers that we support, which you can see on the bottom line there. In addition, any amount over the goal will also be distributed to the 5 mission centers based on need. Next slide, please. No. May 19th is the target date for our foreign missions. September 15th is the target date for the local missions. That will be the remaining 3 times of our weekly giving. With a strong desire to invest in our campus ministries, this support will meet staffing needs at the major universities in our city, SDSU, CSUSM, and UCSD. In addition, singles, youth and family, as well as Spanish leadership. And the overage on the local missions will be allocated as 50% remaining in our worship center and 50% supporting digital. Any questions you have on that, you can see one of our leaders. Okay. Now I'd like to share just a little bit, a few thoughts of my own towards giving. Jesus said, the people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. Matthew 4. And in Matthew 5, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. I love thinking of our weekly contribution as an upkeep to a lighthouse, that the North County Church is that lighthouse in the way that Jesus refers to the use of light in those verses in Matthew. And our weekly contribution is what we give to keep the lighthouse in good working order, well-manned and shining bright. You know, there had to be the first lighthouse built in some port to show sailors the safe way home. Then others saw that this was a good idea and built a second and a third, kind of like what Paul and Barnabas did. And I think of our missions contribution as building lighthouses in ports that have none. And yet, a lighthouse is just what's needed in that locale. Sometimes it's a foreign port many miles from here, and sometimes it's here in our own county. I hope you'll join me today with some enthusiasm in your contribution to strengthen the North County Lighthouse and in upcoming missions contributions to help build new lighthouses where they're needed. Let's pray. Thank you, God, that you dwell among us. Thank you for your spirit through which you speak to us. I pray that we, each one of us in this room today, will take some time to commune with you directly about our personal. You give us every day to our brothers and sisters, the world around us, the opportunity to support the Lighthouse of the North Region Church, and the opportunity to contribute to the building of lighthouses beyond our current borders to better help bring your kingdom to the world today and in the years to come. We pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. Here on the slide, you'll see what's probably familiar territory. If you're contributing today, cash or checks, please make the checks out to SDCC, or you can use the QR code to access the app, which is another way to live.
What a great service it has been today. I don't know about you, but I was in tears and really inspired by today's message. And one takeaway I had was not to get wrapped up in the business of life. We tend to create this huge like checklist for ourselves, and then we just forget that our main focus should just be on Jesus. And I just love that Doug talked about just like priorities, because a lot of the times as a single, I'm like, this is my priority, and this, and this, and this, and then my whole checklist becomes a priority. But I just love in verse 42, it says, few things are needed, or indeed, only one. And that just reminds me that if I focus on that one thing that is needed, life just suddenly becomes less hectic and then more fulfilling. So at this time, I would just ask that one parent can please pick up their kids for children's ministry, and please thank your teachers. They do such an amazing job. So to start all our announcements, I'm going to have Danielle wrap us up for Women's Month. Yeah.
Awesome. March has been really amazing as we get to celebrate the women. Last Saturday, we had our women's brunch. Many of you were there. It was an amazing opportunity to hear from each other, hear from other women, share their stories, and the way that God has really impacted them. Yesterday was really amazing. We had multiple events going on for the women. Tara shared a little bit about her acts of hospitality that she hosted. Sonia and Sonia hosted an amazing event for what it looked like for our more mature single women. And then a few of us actually drove up because May was the speaker for our sister church in Riverside. They had their Women's Day yesterday. So we drove up there, we got to build family and community with our sister church in Riverside as we celebrated the women. As well, we have a few more women's events coming up this month. This Wednesday, actually, via Zoom, we're gonna be having a women's midweek. This Wednesday, if you need the link, we're happy to send that to you. As well as this Saturday, we're gonna be having our women's hike for the North family. That's gonna be right down the street. The women's hike, you guys, is not a sprint. It's not a race. If you don't like to hike, it's okay. Come, put on some comfy shoes. Bring your neighbors, bring your friends. It's a slow walk. Actually, you can walk at your own pace. So if you really want to sprint, you may do that. If you don't, you can walk in the back with me. I am not a fast walker. But it's just going to be a great time to connect with the women. Please be inviting out your friends, your coworkers, and your neighbors.
Thank you. And don't think we forget about the men. The men are also very special. So for midweek, this Wednesday, March 20th, the men are meeting at the San Alejo Rec Center, 7:30. And then for next service, we will be back here next Sunday with some awesome speakers, Mufid and Jesse Talmay, who lead the church in Lebanon. So please come encourage them, and we will be having Coastal and Pomerado joining us for that. And then instead of service Sunday, we will be having a special Easter Sunday that will be coming up March 31st at 10 a.m. here at the San Alejo Middle School. Bring your neighbors and your friends. It's going to be a very special time. And if you don't know about the details, please just look up in your San Diego Church app or ask a friend that invited you to send you all of the information. Thank you so much for joining us today. You are dismissed.